When it comes to music history, I have always had an intense fascination with the era of the garage rock revival that emerged out of New York, Detroit, Seattle, and the UK in the early 2000s. And what has always fascinated me about this particular era of music history is the fact that it represented a last gasp of not only how the music industry used to operate before the internet and streaming, but the fact that it also coincided with the perpetual death of what New York used to be, which was a very different New York from the New York we know now. New York at the turn of the century was a very interesting time to be alive. Believe it or not, the rent in Manhattan wasn't sky high. A lot of struggling artists in town were usually able to find places to cohabitate with one another, whether it be through squatting in dilapidated buildings on the Lower East Side, or rooming in a two-bedroom in Alphabet City with at least 10 other artists. However, this was long before Rudy Giuliani got elected and began cracking down on everything associated with having a good time, anything from drugs to warehouse parties to live concert venues and bars. Everybody with common sense saw him as the enemy. That was until...
This is as close as we can get to the base of the World Trade Center. You can see the firemen assembled here, the police officers, FBI agents, and you can see the two towers. A huge explosion now, raining debris.
9/11, one of the most collectively traumatic incidents in American history, suddenly took Rudy Giuliani, the ultimate nemesis of New York nightlife and the working class, and landed him in the public's good graces. At least for a brief moment. He turned into an overnight hero who cleaned up the city and rid the streets of quote-unquote ne'er-do-wells and troublemakers. And he used his new hero status as an opportunity to double down on his continued attack on New York nightlife. Manhattan clubs were gutted, and the city council made it near impossible for clubs and bars to obtain cabaret licenses that would allow them to play live music and allow people to dance. Police raids in clubs quadrupled, and venues would get fined and even shut down if people were caught dancing. They used the cabaret law to shut down places that had a DJ in the corner, like Plant Bar, where you'd go see James Murphy DJ or people like him. That's what was really sad. It was putting a stake through the heart of that world. On September 30th, 2001, a mere 2 weeks after 9/11, scuzzy Manhattan-based garage rock bohemians The Strokes launched their debut album, Is This It, in the US, an 11-track album detailing the lives of urban youth through narrative storytelling that detailed hookups, partying, and debauchery in an unbridled and grimy tunnel of retro headphone bleed-style production, courtesy of their producer, Gordon Raphael. After the music scene in New York was in a perpetual coma for almost a decade, that album suddenly revived it and spawned the popularity of several other guitar rock bands in their peer group, both in and outside of New York, including Interpol, the White Stripes, and multiple others across the pond like the Libertines and Franz Ferdinand. One of the biggest bands to emerge out of this garage rock explosion was the prolific art rock trio the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, comprised of lead guitarist Nick Zinner, drummer Brian Chase, and lead singer Karen O, an outrageously charismatic firecracker with unrelenting energy and an unforgettable stage persona. Born to South Korean and Polish parents, Karen O, born Karen Lee Orzelek, grew up in Englewood, New Jersey. She first attended liberal arts college at Oberlin in Ohio, where she first met the Yeah Yeah Yeahs drummer Brian Chase, who was attending the Conservatory of Music at Oberlin. Karen and I were freshmen at Oberlin the same year. We lived in the same building. We all called it the monastery and the nunnery because it was like the one and only non-co-ed dorm. We were there begrudgingly, so we kinda got stuck together. There was this orientation field trip for freshmen into Cleveland, and that's where I first met Karen, on the bus. During the winter term of her freshman year, Karen decided to teach herself guitar in order to ward off seasonal depression, and this was when she first tried her hand at songwriting, taking inspiration from the likes of Neil Young and Jeff Mangum from Neutral Milk Hotel. The first song I ever learned was by Mazzy Star. As soon as I learned to play a little guitar, I started writing music. I didn't care about really knowing how to play. I know pretty much as I know now about playing guitar as I knew then. I'm dead serious. It's slightly embarrassing. From the 4 lessons I took when I was 18 years old, I've been able to write hundreds of songs. You don't need to know much to write a good song. After transferring to NYU Tisch School of the Arts, where she studied film, Karen performed as a solo act for the first time ever at Sidewalk Cafe in 1999. And it was at Mars Bar in the East Village where she first met the Yeah Yeah Yeahs guitarist, Nick Zinner. Zinner was playing in a band called Challenge of the Future at the time, and was also side-gigging as a guitarist in several local bands who played at warehouse parties. Owen Zinner started hanging out more regularly and quickly discovered that they shared an affinity for all things music related, and eventually decided to form a folk duo called Unitard. I felt the chemistry from the first time we ever played music together, which was in the summer of 2000. We were just hanging out in her old apartment above Odessa. She was playing songs she'd written on acoustic guitar for me, and I was like, "Those are rad, let me record them and play on them." I immediately knew I would be making music and be somehow involved with her for a while. I felt it. Just whoosh, immediate connection. So we did this Unitard project. However, after playing a few open mic nights at Sidewalk, the Unitard project didn't last very long. Karen soon decided that they should switch things up and start a rock band, which Zinner was a bit reluctant to do at first. This was at least a year before the Strokes had broken into the mainstream, so there wasn't exactly a very prominent rock scene or brewing DIY punk community in New York at the time. But Zinner eventually got on board. One night, Karen and I were in my loft with a drum machine. We drank Brass Monkeys and literally in 2 hours wrote 4 songs, and 2 or 3 of them were on our first EP. Bang was the first song we wrote. The original lineup consisted of Karen on vocals, Zinner on lead guitar, Jack Martin on rhythm guitar, and Rennie Elliott on drums. But Martin and Elliott soon left the band, just before they booked an opening slot at the Mercury Lounge with the White Stripes. It was then that Karen decided to phone her old friend from college, Brian Chase, and ask him to drum for the band at the gig, which was the beginning of Chase's tenure with the Yeah Yeah Yeahs. Karen burst through the doors of the Mercury Lounge with the most undeniably memorable stage presence that harkened back to the shock rock exhibitionism of Wendy O. Williams from the Plasmatics, spewing beer into the crowd, swallowing the mic, displaying outrageous onstage antics that teetered on the edge of self-harm. That show marked the birth of a global superstar, and everyone in the crowd that night could sense it. That's one of the only moments in my life where I'll be able to say, I was there, more so than any other time with a music artist. When I saw Karen O on stage at the Mercury Lounge, I was like, oh, you're gonna be famous. You've got it. I get it. Karen O will always be one of the most special and magnetic forces to ever arise out of the post-punk revival, especially her iconic and unpredictable stage presence, wearing vibrant handmade outfits crafted by her friend, the DIY punk fashion designer Christian Joy. Throughout her long-spanning career, she has collaborated with the Flaming Lips as well as noise rock legends like Michael Hira from Swans, and she has also worked with filmmakers like David Lynch and Spike Jonze. She even recorded the soundtrack for the 2009 film adaptation of the classic children's book Where the Wild Things Are. The Yeah Yeah Yeahs' breakout debut album Fever to Tell was self-financed by the band and produced by TV on the Radio's Dave Satek. The result was a melange of garage art punk tracks with spiky percussion and fuzzy lo-fi riffs that emulated early Velvet Underground records, complemented by a vocal delivery from Karen that combined the soulfulness of Aretha Franklin with the signature primal yowls of Susie Sue and PJ Harvey. The band secured a global hit with the single Maps, a love song that quickly shot to number 9 on the Billboard alternative charts. The song was a heart-wrenchingly vulnerable heartbreak ballad that Karen had dedicated to her boyfriend at the time, Angus Andrew from The Liars. We wrote it in Nick's room with the blue drum machine and a 4-track recorder. I was really lovelorn at the time. "They Don't Love You Like I Love You" was straight from a love letter, and I just plucked it out of there because I thought it had a good ring to it. Just a simple statement that really stuck with people. You know, I say love letter, but it was a fucking email. Motherfucker. You know what? I'm going to rewrite history right here. I wrote it with a quill. It was a feather quill, written in blood. It might as well have been. There was a lot of love in that song, but there's a lot of fear too. I exposed myself so much with that song. I kind of shocked myself. The accompanying music video for Maps was directed by Patrick Daughters, with the band playing the song in a school gymnasium, the camera focusing squarely on Karen's face as she sang. And right as Nick Zinner began to rip into his earth-shattering solo, she started to cry. They were real tears. My boyfriend at the time was supposed to come to the shoot. He was 3 hours late, and I was just about to leave for tour. I didn't think he was even going to come, and this was literally the song that was written for him. He eventually showed up, and I got myself into a real emotional state. In 2006, the Yeah Yeah Yeahs eventually took the major label leap and signed to Interscope Records, which distributed their following albums, Show Your Bones, It's Blitz, and Mosquito. It's Blitz saw the band achieve another hit with Heads Will Roll, a sardonically menacing disco-infused rager told from the perspective of the Queen of Hearts in Lewis Carroll's Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, and the song peaked at number 14 on Billboard. During her tenure with the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, Karen O built up a bit of a reputation for refusing to get caught up in the vanity that comes with global superstardom. In 2006, her management at the time received a furious phone call from Jimmy Iovine when she refused to do a cover shoot for Vanity Fair. At the height of the Yeah Yeah Yeahs' career, she refused to do any kind of feature or interview unless accompanied by the rest of the band, and she has continued to remain faithful to her indie DIY roots, despite her audience having grown a sizable amount ever since Maps started to sweep the globe in 2003.
Not a single time have I ever regretted saying, like, no to something that felt wrong, you know?
Karen's eclectic range spans all genres, from collaborating with hip-hop supergroups to recording soundtracks to children's movies. In 2014, she released a paradisiacal lo-fi album of love songs entitled Crush Songs, which was distributed through Julian Casablancas' independent label Cult Records. In 2019, Karen teamed up with the Grammy-winning producer Danger Mouse on a 9-track album entitled Lux Prima, with songs that contained ethereal, laid-back orchestrations that bonded like a magnet to Karen's otherworldly, airy vocals that harken back to Beth Gibbons of Portishead. Karen has expressed a few times that she's often felt like the black sheep, as one of the only women who rose to fame in a sea of dudes. And while she has managed to find a way to create her own rules and use her own unique experience as a woman as an advantage, that hasn't made her position any less harmful to her personally. As she told Lizzie Goodman, "I felt super isolated and super lonely because I could never fully relate to my bandmates and peers. I could relate to them only to a certain degree. And they're the bomb. They're so progressive, wise, intuitive, really fucking wonderful, rocking human beings. But they're dudes, you know? In the end, they're not fellow ladies." However, Karen's femininity also proved to be one of her biggest strengths. She brought a perspective of her own that was a necessary departure from the overblown machismo of her male-dominated peer groups. As she said so eloquently, there's a legacy that is laid out. There's a canon of rock and roll, and a lot of men worship that and kneel at the altar of that. I didn't have to play by those rules. To explore this further, I'm going to hand it off to my friend Val of the amazing channel Sets in the CD. Take it away, Val.
To say that Karenau is an electrifying powerhouse of creativity is an understatement. During her career alongside the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, she collaborated with an almost endless array of artists. From psych pop and Flaming Lips, to the unsettling sounds of Swans, and a brief stint in hip-hop alongside NASA, as well as a number of award-winning nominated soundtracks, and even the musical debut of iconic surrealist movie director David Lynch. But the hallmark of what makes Karen a bona fide indie icon is her unforgettable essence. In a scene dominated by the cock rock of the early aughts garage revival, she was able to stand out by the sheer virtue of having a presence so powerful and explosive that it was pretty much impossible not to notice her. She subverted the expectations of the scene, because she wasn't just a chick from the songs her contemporaries sung about. Instead, she made her own tunes, shining on stage with a signature brand of energetic vibrance that paved the way for the new millennium to inspire a whole new generation of women to make history in the indie scene. But what strikes me as even more compelling about Karen is her ever-accessible vulnerability. And no project puts it in better display than the 2014 lo-fi gem that is her debut studio album, Crush Songs, which is a window to the love-learned side of Karen we've briefly met in Maps. It was written and recorded when she was just 27 years old and unsure of whether she'd fall in love ever again. "I crushed a lot," she said of that time, which was what led her to make what became the soundtrack to an ever-continuing love crusade. We get a chance to see the real fighter behind their bombastic exterior. The one that reminds us that real strength flows through every phase of femininity, from badass flamboyance and grit to loud disco realness, and even in the quiet moments where we're just sitting around, strumming a guitar to pass the time, and thinking about the ones that got away. So thank you, Karen, and thank you, Izzy, for having me on to talk about this icon.
There's a real agency and nuance to Karen's work. And that's what makes her work timeless, and her impact is deeply felt. She's influenced so many young women in music today. Stephanie Phillips from the influential Afropunk band Big Joni has cited Karen O as her number one inspiration. And lo-fi Gen Z darling Biba Doobie recently covered Karen's The Moon Song. What makes Karen O's work so special is the fact that it embodies every facet of the human experience, as well as every facet of femininity. As Val so eloquently said, she's never been afraid to show her vulnerable side and her squishy heart beneath the hardened surface of the classic rock and roll pose she often flaunted early in her career. She refuses to be confined or shoehorned into the monolith that so many women in entertainment are reduced to, whether it be the archetype of the chanteuse, the cool girl, or the tough chick. She transcends all of that. She means the world to femmes, queers, girls, women, men, and boys alike. And that type of figure rarely graces our earth with their presence. Which is why we are so damn lucky to be sharing the earth with this icon.